You know, there was a certain philosopher who said that religion was the opiate of the people. And this is sort of the true believer thing. Well, the state, national security is the thing you don't touch. It's the untouchable. If it's for national security, it must be for all the right reasons, no matter what the reason is.
This rhetoric that, oh, security is the first of all freedoms. First of all, it's untrue. It's untrue because in the French Constitution, and I don't know about the others, there is not a notion of security, but a notion of safety that is defined as safety against the arbitrary of the state. So safety against the unjustified use of power by the state.
It's emerged that it was the Prime Minister who instructed Britain's most senior civil servant to tell the Guardian newspaper to destroy a computer which held files from the whistleblower Edward Snowden.
I think the plain fact is that what has happened has damaged national security.
We were faced effectively with an ultimatum from the British government that if we didn't hand back the material or destroy it, they would move to law. The state can effectively prevent a news publisher from publishing.
The right to know. We need the right to know. The people need the right to know. Not only the freedom of speech, the right to know.
If you just cover it with the label, call it national security, then you can get away with anything.
Well, you mentioned prevent earlier on, and to be honest, for me, that's one of the most scary things about the way that this legislation is going. In the UK, a four-year-old kid couldn't say cucumber properly, and it sounded like he said cooking bomb. And he drew a picture of his father cutting a cucumber, and the knife is obviously very disproportionate because the child is a four-year-old, yeah? Not great at art yet. Something as simple as a spelling mistake or a bad drawing can suddenly be something to cause a security threat and a security concern. They have so far trained around 360,000 public sector workers to spot signs of radicalization. I speak to my friends who have children, and I say to them, like, what do you tell your kids? How do you deal with having this hanging over you?
Yeah.
And their response is, we say if they ask you anything about politics, if they ask you anything about Islam, just say you don't know. And we're telling our children now to be dumb and to not speak out and not express an opinion,
yeah,
because we're scared.
So in essence, national security has given centralized governments, state governments, license to do all kinds of things in the shadows, away from the public interest.
Graphic new details of the post 9/11 U.S. torture program came to light Tuesday when the Senate Intelligence Committee released a 500-page summary of its investigation into the CIA. The report concluded the intelligence agency failed to disrupt a single plot despite torturing al-Qaeda and other captives in secret prisons worldwide between 2002 and 2006.
I'm more concerned with bad guys who got out and released than I am with a few in fact, were innocent.
And yet there are those who are addicted to that kind of power.
I'd do it again in a minute.
And yes, a direct threat to who we are.
We turn now to the man who blew the whistle on the National Security Agency and the expanding U.S. surveillance state.
So the philosophy was, we've got to start eavesdropping on everybody in order to find out who the terrorists are and where they are.
Nowadays, with the Edward Snowden leaks, people are saying, oh, well, it's only metadata we're collecting.
That's what they're trying to dupe everybody into thinking that it's nothing.
It's not something very abstract. This is not some data of yours. This is about your life and the ability to interfere with your life and with your freedom to act.
To me, national security, when it metastasizes in the way that it has, especially over the last 15, 16 years, although the foundation for this was laid during the Cold War, let's not forget that those infrastructures never did actually go away. It's pointing a dagger at the heart of democracy. And ultimately, that means it's pointing at us.
Know that all the great law reforms in British history, all the great successful social movements came about as a result of not a handful of people like me, but a mass movement of people who said, we've had enough, we want change.
That whistleblowers are now the regulators of last resort.